Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Tim Besley, and I'm really delighted to welcome you to this afternoon's webinar on political inequalities. I can assure you that this will be a pleasurable way to ease yourself into the weekend and an alternative to watching endless games of World Cup football. The topic, as I said, of today's event is political inequalities. It's an event in support of the IFS Deaton Review on Inequalities, and I should particularly note the support of our sponsor, the Nuffield Foundation. We have a superb panel for you today. During the webinar, you'll have opportunities to put your questions on Slido, and we will keep an eye on that, and you can vote for which questions you think are the ones that you would most like the panel to address. The Deaton Review is looking at inequalities from a number of different angles. And early on in the process of trying to think about what the project would cover, it was clear that the topic of political inequalities would be a central part of that, and also reflect the ambition of the review to be multidisciplinary, since after all, these are not just topics that are familiar to economists, they're more in the terrain, one might say, of political science. And two of our panelists today are political scientists. Unlike many kinds of economic inequality, it's far from agreed upon as to what we mean by political inequality. And that's one of the topics I think that will come up almost certainly in today's panel. Most people, I think, at least understand intuitively that democratic societies, by their nature, pursue a certain kind of political equality. But just what that means in practice, I think, is not entirely clear. There's no doubt that if you look at progress, human progress over the last, say, 200 years, there have been quite significant changes in formal political equality. People have the right to vote. Most adults have the right to vote in the world's main democracies. But the question of whether we've achieved a high or middling or even low degree of political equality, I think very much depends on how you look at the issues. I think another important issue in the field is whether we think political inequality is an intrinsic equality to be studied in its own right, or is it mainly important because if you have more political equality, that allows people to express themselves and achieve more from the state. So there's also questions about the purpose of political equality. And again, I hope that's something we can get into today. As I said earlier, we have an excellent panel. We're first going to hear from Ben Ansell on a joint piece of work that's been done to support the review with Jane Gingrich. And Jane will also join for the panel discussion and the Q&A part of the event today. And then we'll hear from Julia Caget, who's also written an interesting piece for the review. Ben will speak for approximately 15 minutes, and then Julia will. And then there should be plenty of time to have a discussion, to listen to the answers to the questions you put on Slido. I may have a few questions of my own, and I hope by the end of the afternoon, we will all be much wiser than we are now on this very interesting and important topic. So at this point, I'll hand over to Ben, who will then transition at the end of his 15 minutes to Julia, at which point you'll hear back from me as I try to moderate the discussion that will ensue. So over to you, Ben.
Thank you very much, Tim. I'm just going to share my screen and the slides, which I hope everybody can see. They've appeared for me, so I'll assume that they've appeared for you too. Thank you. I wanted to begin by thanking the review team, and in particular Angus, Tim, Richard and Paul, who invited Jane and myself to contribute to this, and it's great to be part of something that's actually interdisciplinary. We talk a lot about it in the academy, so it's nice to actually do it for once. Today's chapter is very long. So if you go to the IFS website and you download it, you'll discover it's 22,000 words of length. There's a lot to say about political inequality, we discovered, and Tim alluded to some of the issues in talking about political inequality earlier, which is it could be a whole host of things. And so the first slide that I have asks that broad question, what do we mean when we say political inequality? And on the right hand side of this slide, you'll see a flowchart that Jen and I put together for the review piece, where we are drawing a line from what you might think of as the inputs into politics, that is voters and what they want, through to the outputs of politics, that is the policies produced and how voters feel about those policies. And of course, in the middle, we have the trickiness of Parliament that has to somehow translate what voters say they want into policies at the end. And so if you think about this very long interconnected chain within our political system, we could have greater or lesser political equality or inequality at any of these points. And indeed, we could have, you know, excellent political equality in terms of all of our voters turning out to vote and legislators ignoring them entirely. Or in a different world, we might have legislators producing exactly what the people want, even though few of them vote. So it's a tough concept to talk about. And it's useful for us to think about political inequality or equality, and obviously one is one extreme or the other, in these five steps. So who turns out to vote? And in particular, is it the case that people from higher, without wishing to use that term too loosely, higher socioeconomic groups with more status, are they more likely to turn out to vote, right? So we could have a political inequality there because only the rich or homeowners or the highly educated turn out to vote. The second step where we might have a form of political inequality is the degree to which economic differences translate into political differences in terms of who people vote for. So if people don't care at all about their own economic circumstances when they vote, then it might be that economic inequalities don't translate at all into politics. Equivalently, we could have a situation where everybody sort of votes their income, and then the economic polarization we have would produce political polarization. And so we might think about the translation between economic inequality and political inequality through representation that way. And then now if we turn to politicians, we might look at politicians and say, are they representative of the country that they nominally govern? And if they're not, is that a form of political inequality? So if all politicians are as they were in the early part of the 20th century, older, white, usually more wealthy, usually more educated men, we might think of that as unrepresentative and politically unequal in some way. And so we call this concept descriptive representation. Is it the case that Parliament looks like the people that it purports to represent? But even if you have a parliament that looks just like the population, that doesn't necessarily mean that they will produce the types of policies that population want, right? So we could have MPs coming from very wealthy backgrounds, but making policy for poorer citizens or vice versa. And so then we have a question about the types of policies that get produced and whether they ultimately represent the interests of the rich or they represent the interests of everybody or the poor and so on. And then finally, we have to think about how voters feel about this whole process that we began with when they turned out to vote. Are people happy? Do they feel the system is representative? Do poorer people feel less represented by the system? And is that a form of inequality we should care about? So what I'm going to do in the remaining 12 or so minutes I have is I'm going to try and go through a number of these steps and talk about the findings that Jen and I have. And in particular, we're going to focus on the first part on the representation front. So what we did when we analyzed that is we took elections going back to 1964, so you can see Harold Wilson on the top right there, all the way up to 2019, the Boris Johnson victory. And we look at the British Election Survey in each of those years, and we harmonize the data so that we can have consistent indicators of people's income, where we use income quintiles for that year. So are you in the lowest fifth, the highest fifth of voters by income in that year? We use a harmonized version of education, which is a 3-point scale from lower secondary education or less to upper secondary to university degrees. And then we have rather simpler things, age, gender, and whether people own homes or not. And what we're interested in is two things. The first, what we'll look at in a second, is are there important differences in the way that inequalities socioeconomically translate into differences in whether people turn out to vote at all? Right. So is there a political inequality in the act of participation? And then secondly, How do the differences in socioeconomic structure of Britain translate into the choices that people make for particular parties? In other words, if we're economically polarized, does that mean we become politically polarized? So the way I'm going to do this is I'm going to show you a whole bunch of graphs at once. And this is turnout. So each of these graphs looks a little bit complex, but it's not too rough once I explain it, I hope. So we have four graphs. Each of these represents a relationship between a demographic factor at the individual level in the survey, so something about the survey respondents, and whether they turned out to vote at the election or not. And the x-axis of each of these graphs is year. So we go from elections in 1964 all the way up to 2019. So as we move along the x-axis, we're moving along in time. And what the y-axis is, and this is important for this in the next graph, is it's the measure of association between that factor, like income or education, age or home ownership, and whether people chose to turn out or not. So in most of these cases, we have a little dotted line at zero. And so the fact that all these numbers and the lines around them, which are our estimates and our confidence in those estimates, the fact that they're above the line means that higher income or higher education, higher age, or owning a house is associated, in all of these cases, in fact, with being more likely to turn out. Okay, so it's always been the case in British politics back to 1964 that people with higher incomes, people who have higher educational qualifications, people who are older, or people who own houses are more likely to turn out to vote. But what I want you to note here is that in most of these cases, we have an upward incline in this relationship. And so that in particular from the late 90s onwards, around the Blair election, we get an increase in the importance of these socioeconomic factors in terms of whether people are likely to come out to vote. So the take homes at the bottom, older people, more educated people, richer people, and people who own houses have become ever more likely to vote. So you can think of that as if there has been an increase in economic inequality over time in the UK, and there certainly was in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, that may have spilled into political inequalities where poorer, less educated renters who are younger respond to being on the bad side of economic inequality by simply not showing up. Okay, so that's one conclusion of our study. But there's a flip side to this, which is that those same factors, income, age, home ownership, that make people more likely to turn out in present elections, increasingly so, don't have the same effect when we look at who people vote for. So this series of graphs looks at whether people voted for the Conservative Party. And because the UK is a two-party system, if we had Labour, it would largely flip all of these graphs. Okay, so we can just think of this as an indication of the importance of these factors for voting. Okay. What we see is that traditionally higher income voters have voted conservative, traditionally older voters have voted conservative, traditionally homeowners have voted conservative, but there's a couple of interesting things going on in the last few years. So if you look on the left, you'll see with income that the last dash and dot that we have on the line there is the 2019 election. And whereas richer voters have voted for the Conservative Party fairly consistently back to the 1960s, that dropped off a cliff in the Boris Johnson victory, which means that essentially income stopped predicting whether people voted for the Conservative Party in 2019. Okay. And the other thing I want to point attention to is education. It used to be that people with degrees or people indeed with upper secondary education were much more likely to vote for the Conservative Party. But since the late 80s and early 90s, that relationship has started to reverse, and it's accelerated that reverse. So that in 2019, the effect of education had completely reversed from 1964. So having a degree made you about 10% points more likely to vote for the Conservatives in 1964, but it made you about 10% more likely to vote for Labour by 2019. And that means that if we think about rising inequality and its effects on political polarization, it's not quite as clear as our turnout effects, right? We've got rising inequality, but we don't have a rising polarization in terms of income with regard to how people vote. In fact, if anything, that polarization collapsed in the last election. And where we have polarization is in education, but it's not in a way where higher sort of socioeconomic status groups, that is people with degrees, are voting for the Conservative Party anymore. They've actually flipped and voting for the Labour Party. So it's not completely clear that we should say that income polarization has led to polarization has led to political polarization in the UK. That doesn't appear to be the case, at least in terms of how people vote. And that's even more clear when we look at this set of graphs, which are at the constituency level. So here along the x-axis of of each of these graphs, we have the median house price by constituency in 1997 on the left, for Brexit in the middle, and on the right in 2019. And this is logged to keep Kensington and Chelsea in the graph. But we have on the y-axis votes for the Conservative Party in 97, votes for Remain in 2016, and votes in 2019 for the Conservative Party again. And so what I want you to notice here is in 1997, there's a pretty strong positive relationship between local wealth and local voting for the Conservative Party. And the 108 constituencies with the lowest house prices in 1997 all voted Labour. And the Conservatives won 43 out of the 50 wealthiest constituencies. In other words, local wealth really, really correlated with how people voted in 1997. Class politics translated into the form of political polarization we had in Britain. If you jump to the right, all the way to the right, you'll see in the 2019 election, there's basically no relationship at all. Right? So local wealth does not predict anything about whether areas were more or less likely to vote for the Conservative Party. And so again, what we're seeing is even though incomes have polarized in Britain over the last 30 or 40 years, the role of local income in polarizing politics has dropped. And that, I think, is a surprise. And the main reason for that is our middle picture here, which is the relationship between local house prices and Brexit voting. And this is done at the constituency level, even though the Brexit voting was in fact done at the local authority level. Chris Hanratty provides a way of figuring out what it would have been at the constituency level. And so what we see here is that wealthier areas were more likely to vote to Remain. And that has scrambled our standard geographic class politics in the UK in ways that have depolarized the UK around income, but of course repolarized it around education. And so that means we have what Jenny and I call a political paradox, which is that income and wealth gaps between rich and poor have risen over the last half century, although that's sort of stabilized over the last 10 to 15 years. But the importance of income and local wealth in defining vote choice has either been stable or declined. Right? So polarization by income hasn't led to political polarization. It's led to polarization in voting by education. And that means that we might have political inequality in the UK, but it's connected more to people's education and age. And on the right here, we have some figures that show the importance in the last few elections of these factors in marginal versus non-marginal seats. And all I want to point to is at the bottom left, we see that in non-marginal, so in safe seats, education has become more important over the last few elections, meaning that Conservative areas and Labour areas look ever less alike in terms of their educational composition. So I'm going to finish off, sorry if I can click through on the slides, with a couple of things about representation in Parliament and in policy, and then Julia will pick up much more on this. And Julia, I think, has a lot of really interesting things to say, so I won't bury her lead on this. But just to note, if we look at descriptive representation in Parliament, on the whole, there's been a convergence to the public. That is, in terms of demographics like gender and ethnicity and age, Parliament looks more like the population. Sometimes that's because Parliament has become more like the population, as is the case with gender. Sometimes the population has become more like Parliament, as is the case in age. In educational terms, that's also true. So MPs still all go to university. More of them went to university. So 80% go now rather than 60%. But the population on the whole is also going to university more. The only place where we see less convergence is in occupational structure. And here you can see in the bottom right hand corner that very, very few MPs worked in the manual occupations before entering Parliament. So that form of descriptive representation really, really hasn't improved, even though others have. A couple of final points we want to make in terms of policy and how represented people feel. We have a very long section in the chapter where we talk about policies related to welfare, policies related to pensions, policies related to education, policies relating to home building, to try and get a sense of how responsive parties have been to general public opinion. And I think the consensus view on this is that overall, Westminster and the public are thermostatic with regard to one another. So in other words, when spending gets cut a lot, the public want more spending, and when spending gets high, the public want less. And when the public want more spending, politicians eventually respond themselves. So they go back and forth in response to one another. However, over time, There does seem to have been a secular trend where policymakers respond increasingly to the needs of older voters rather than the population as a whole. So the graph on the right here, taken from the British Social Attitude Study, shows support for retirement spending as a priority versus child benefit spending for a priority. And you'll see among all groups, the view about retirement spending being a priority is going down over time. But that, of course, is not what's happening with retirement spending by the government. People want more child benefit spending, but of course, that's been cut since 2010. So to some degree, politicians are not being responsive in generational terms. And so let me finish with our final set of empirical results, which look at British election surveys again, going back now to 1987, where there's a question that's been asked about whether people like you have no say in politics. And the main thing I want you to note here is over time, more people feel like that. So people do feel less represented over time. So this is another form of political inequality, and this has been rising with economic inequality. But what's also quite interesting is the last couple of elections have seen a narrowing in that gap. So people have become more like one another. Top income people and people with degrees in particular have responded to the last few elections by being quite angry about how they don't feel less represented anymore, right? So this has been sort of a turn against the graduate class. And so there has been some equalization, but we've all become equally discontent. So some take homes from this. Inequality in terms of turnout has widened dramatically, along the lines of economic inequality, but that's not been the case in terms of voting polarization. We don't see income polarization producing political polarization around income. Instead, we've got polarization around education, which of course is related to income, but not the same thing. Parliament looks increasingly like the public. Sometimes that's because Parliament's been moving in its direction. Sometimes public has been moving in Parliament's direction. And I think broadly we can say that policymakers have been in tune with public opinion, but in a way that systematically favours older generations. And people still aren't particularly happy. They're just all equally unhappy. So I'll stop at that point and pass over to Julia. I hope I haven't taken too much of her time here.
Tak. Thank you very much. Thanks for giving me the first of all the opportunity to participate in the review and like to talk today. I have to say that like Ben gave you a great overview of the work he did with Jane, and I was glad that Tim asked me to review and to comment on the chapter. Because to be totally honest, I learned a lot on it. I learned a lot on the different dimensions of political inequality. Ben went through that in his presentation, but I think it was it's very important to see all the different implications and all the different dimensions that we need to take into account when we talk about political inequality. And now, like Ben just did a summary of the work he did with Jane. But if you go through the chapter, you will have even more evidence on the relationship between political inequality and economic inequality over the past decades in the UK. And I think that the kind of plots that were just shown during this presentation raise a huge number of very interesting questions. First, to try to understand what is happening, but I think it's also raise interesting questions in terms of political platforms for the different political movements. So I really have to say that I learned a lot, and it was hard for me, even harder today with like 15 minutes, but it was hard for me, like in just like a 10, 15 page, to pick some issues, to try to push further when I wrote the comment, because there are already like so many things that are like covered in the chapter. So what I want to insist on, the first thing is the issue of unequal descriptive representations. So Ben already showed us some evidence of that. I think what really matters, and that matters in terms of policy implemented, but that matters also in terms of the quality of democracy, is this idea of who politicians are. I think it's hard to define political inequality. Something else that is very hard to define is what representation means. One aspect that has been underestimated for years, and now that is kind of back in the discussion because of the lack of descriptive representation, is this idea of having like a representation of like a female in parliament, representation of like blue collar workers in parliament, or representation of like minorities, for example, in parliament. If you look today around the world, what is still like striking is overall the lack of representation, even if on some dimensions it has improved over time, but on some other dimensions, on the contrary, we see something that is more often increasing representation graph. So what Ben and Jane do in their chapter is to provide great evidence of that from the UK. This has also been documented, this lack of descriptive representation. For example, if you look at blue collar workers in the case of the US, and I recommend you strongly to go through the work of Nicolas Carnes, for example, that established like long-term figures of the lack of like blue collars representation in the US. Here I'm just showing you like one plot for France back in 1958. So you know, between 1958 and like today, like 2022, in France, if you look at the share of blue collar workers, it has never been like above 10% overall among MPs. And what we observe in the long run is that this share has been decreasing, and now it's like around like 3%. So some people might argue that it makes sense because you have also a change in the overall composition of the population, and de facto there is a little bit less blue collar worker in the overall population today than like 60 years ago. But obviously the drop in the blue collar population is never like close to this very like small share that we observe. So this lack of descriptive representation, we see that if we focus on the issue of like social class representation, so this question of like blue collar workers, we also see that if we look at other dimensions. So I'm going to show you like two plots. One is about gender and the other one is about age. So this plot is on the UK, where you see the long-term evolution. So let's first focus on the blue line with dots. You see the long-term evolution of the share of candidates, and in the green line with triangle, the share of elected candidates that are women in the UK. So one of the things that Ben highlighted is that we are doing better. And that's true. Like before, like, and in fact, until the end of the 1970s, this share was like below 10%. Now it's kind of reaching 30%. So like a positive way to see that is to say that, okay, look at the trend. We should reach like 50% at some point. Some calculations have been done saying that perhaps not for the UK, but on average, despite the Beijing decision in 1995 to try to have like more female representation in among politicians, on average it will take like 155 years to reach like a parity in terms of gender. So we are doing better, but somehow slightly better. And if you look at age, you also see like the difference between the overall population that you have here with a gray line and the share of candidates and elected candidates. And here you see one of the facts that Ben also highlighted in his presentation, that in a sense the population is looking like more and more like the politicians. One of the things that I want to insist on here is the following, and it's why I put these two plots, that I do think that it's important not only to look at the MPs, so not only to look at the elected candidates, but to also look at the unsuccessful candidates. Because part of the problem, so obviously, I won't have time to enter into all the details, but part of the problem when we look at political inequality, and in particular, the lack of descriptive representation, is that this takes place not only at the time of the election. So this is not as if it was only about like voters who prefer to vote for male than for female, or who prefers to vote for like white collar than for blue collar workers. But it takes place, in fact, at the time of like picking the candidates for elections. And so we also see, you know, the unequal representation of like blue collars, of female, of like young people among the candidates. And then the key question is kind of why. And I think one of the questions we should have is the extent to which party leaders from time to time are ready to lose vote. so that not to have, even if it come, let's say, at an electoral cost in terms of vote. So we could have like a 2 hour discussion about why we should care about descriptive representation. And Ben already gave us a number of arguments, to which I have to add that there is like a huge literature that show that, for example, if you elect some female, they are not going to behave like male in terms of like the policies are going to implement. What I want to highlight here is one thing, is the fact that political inequality comes at a cost. The previous two plot I show you are from joint work I have with Edgar DeWitt, with a fantastic PhD student at Sciences Po Paris, with who we collected data on the characteristics of the MP and of the unsuccessful candidates in the UK back in 1970. And one of the things that we wanted to show and that we document is the fact that when voters are faced with a pool of candidates that do not look like them, they tend to turn out less. So there is just a cost in terms of like the quality of democracy, just the fact that people do not decide to participate. And one of the things that is striking when you move back in 1970s and you look until like 2022 is to see that this cost of the representation gap, if anything, it has increased very strongly in recent years. And in my view, that might also be linked to the rise of far-right parties. And this is like consistent with the work of Ernesto Dalbo with co-authors. And in fact, you have like two or three like super good and interesting papers, in particular on Sweden, because with Swedish data, we have very good information on the candidates that explain the role played by descriptive representation in the rise, in particular, of the Sweden Democrats. In Sweden, two more things, because I try to be short for the sake of times. Ben has highlighted the relationship between economic inequalities and political inequalities, in particular, because if you have a lot of like political inequalities, this might lead to some economic policies that are just going to benefit a small part of the population. What I want to highlight here is the fact that in a sense, there is a vicious circle between political inequality and economic inequality. Why? Because at the end of the day, this is some data I collected for France as part of a book on, called the Price of Democracy. When I looked, even in a country like France, when there are like strong caps on campaign donations, I looked at the concentration of political contributions. And what you see is that only people at the very top of the income distribution, so here people are ranked depending on their income, only people at the very top of the income distributions, they tend to contribute to political parties, which obviously has implications on the policies that are then implemented by these political parties. One of the this second plot is on the UK, and one of the things that I just want to highlight with this plot that also came from the Price of Democracy is that if you look at a party such as the Labour Party, what is striking is that if you think about this plot and if you think about the evolution of the representation of blue-collar workers among Labour Party MPs for a very long time in the UK, and this has never been the case in a country like France, but for a very long time in the UK, due to the strong relationship between the unions and the Labour Party, there were a lot of MPs among Labour Party MPs. There were a lot of like blue-collars among Labour Party MPs in the 50s, 60s, the share was above 30%. And now it collapsed to levels that are close to what we see for the Conservative Party. And one possible explanation for that is the fact that at the end of the day, what we observe today is that the Labour Party is looking more and more like the Conservative Party in terms of where its money comes from. And in particular, we see here, if you look at the y-axis on the right, the fact that the Labour Party as of today in the UK rely increasingly on private donations for its funding, while like historically it was relying much more on money coming from the trade union. I think this needs to be taken into account because it really means that you have like two mechanisms in a sense through which we can see like increasing political inequality in the future. The first one is really this vicious circle between economic inequality and political inequality. So the more political inequality, the more economic inequality, because political inequality are going to affect the policies implemented by the elected politicians. And the second thing is that at the end of the day, this political inequality can also translate directly in the kind of politicians that are elected. It means that economic inequality are going to increase political inequality, that can increase the representation gap. And as we saw, this representation gap comes at a cost, and in particular, the cost that part of the population might just decide not to come and turn out. So just to conclude, I strongly recommend you to go and read the chapter by Ansel Ben and Jen. Again, it's like you will learn a lot. And it's like on top of like being very interesting, like with new numbers and figures, I think it's like a great review of everything that we already know about political inequality. I like insisted like in my comments on like two dimensions that I think are very important, like in particular an equal descriptive representation and the issue of the funding of democracy. Of course, other dimensions need to be taken into account. I think, for example, that the one of the ownership of the media is playing a very important role, in particular also in explaining the persistence of political inequality. I think the good news is that solutions can be found, and it also means that both, as social scientists, whether we are like economists, like political scientists, or like sociologists, we need to like try to like evaluate whether or not these solutions can work at reducing political inequality. First of all, we might want to try to implement new forms of affirmative actions. So we know more and more about the efficiency or lack of efficiency of gender quotas, but it can be improved. I just want to highlight the fact that, for example, in a country like Brazil, this year they have decided to combine quotas that are gender quotas together with the use of public funding of parties as a way to give people incentives to vote more for women and minorities. So we can be innovative, you know, and we can think together about like political inequality and campaign funding and public money for like democracy. I think part of what should be done, and I'm going to conclude with that, is obviously to think about the regulation of the power of private money in democracies. And in particular, I think very important in the British context, what always struck me for having worked like in a let's say historical comparative perspective on the regulation of campaign finance is that in a sense the UK was the very first country worldwide historically to have introduced campaign finance regulation with some cap on how much candidates can spend. We have a lot of data. We have data back in 1857 in the UK on how much candidates spend for legislative elections, for general elections, because this was made compulsory, you know, for candidates to report all their expenditures for at each election. And at the end of the day, you know, if you look at public funding for elections in the UK, it has still not been introduced. Something like very, very slowly, but not to a large scale. And the discussions, you know, about like whether or not we should ban corporate donations in the UK or cap individual donation is still happening. And in a sense, it's kind of far from being like conclusive. Again, the good news is that it means that we can do a lot to try to improve today's situation. But that it also means that political willingness to reduce political inequalities would be needed. So thanks again for giving me the opportunity to comment on this chapter.
Thank you very much, Julia and Ben. And I'll bring in Jane, will join the panel now as well. There she is, great. Well, thank you a lot. And we're getting lots of interest in the questions that are being asked. So I'll go straight into one of them because it actually relates to something I was going to ask about myself, which is, so arguably one of the biggest issues is what you might call voluntary exclusion from politics. That, you know, the UK has pretty low turnout rates. It depends which country you want to compare it with. I mean, compared to US, it doesn't, but compared with many of the countries that we like to compare ourselves. So, one interpretation of that is, you know, people don't participate because they're content with the status quo. But as you know, if you actually start to look at what people think, the people who don't vote, in some ways are the most strongly disaffected. And they're a very significant fraction of the population. And surely that sort of voluntary exclusion is a very key dimension. In the questions, this was a question that David Vincent posed on the website. So I wonder, could you perhaps tell us how you think about that, and what measures, to put it more sort of positively, what measures do you think might be taken? And actually, I'll join that to the second most popular question. There's a proposal to introduce stronger forms of ID for being allowed to vote. Do you think that's just going to go in the opposite direction and disaffect or discourage even more people? So I guess I'd like to throw that open. And if Jane doesn't mind, I'll come to you first, Jane, to give your reflections on that, and then we'll pass it around.
Yeah, thanks. So, I mean, I think there's a couple things going on. I mean, to sort of start at the last part of your question, which is that we know that there's all sorts of small things that can increase or reduce turnout in a particular election, that if you put more barriers up to people voting and you make it more difficult, then that can have a negative effect on people's ability to turn out. And so I think that when we're thinking about sort of things like IDs and so on, we need to weigh the costs in terms of making things more complex and difficult, and particularly for particular kinds of communities where the cost may be borne more heavily, against whatever concerns there are about sort of transparency and so on within the election. But I think the bigger question is the sort of more structural factors that Julia's presentation pointed to in terms of turnout as it relates to descriptive representation and the feelings that people have of efficacy in the system as a whole. And I think that there's sort of some mid-range things that we can think about, which is that we know that, you know, in the classic framework from Schlossman, Brady, and Verba on participation, that there's sort of the kind of the reasons people don't participate is, you know, no one asked them, they didn't have time, they didn't have the resources to do it. And some of those things actually can be, we can think about sort of the mid-level things like parties actually mobilizing people and providing them with candidates that are more descriptively representative, that I think that are sort of in between these longer term trends in inequalities and access to resources and the sort of shorter term transaction costs or costs that people face in going to the ballot box. And these are areas where there's really been a lot of change over time in terms of parties' mobilization strategy and the kind of consistency of that mobilization strategy between elections. The ability to kind of field candidates that are more descriptively representative of parts of the population, and the sort of sorting of voters into different constituencies, in which you get a lot of like voters piled up in one constituency, which might discourage some voters from turning out because they don't feel that their vote has much of an impact. And I think when we're thinking about these things from kind of like the more proximate causes to the more structural ones, the places where potentially there's the most room for change in the sort of medium run is really thinking about mobilization and the way that political parties are actually mobilizing a broader set of voters. I'll stop there and sorry, let other people come in.
I don't know if Ben or Julia want to come in on this topic.
I just have two very quick points on that. The first, you mentioned voter ID, and I just wrote a blog post about the Deaton review chapter earlier this afternoon. And one of the things that I mentioned in passing there, but I hadn't really thought a great deal about, is, gosh, it looks like voter ID is going to be less likely to be held by all the people who already don't turn out very much in the graphs that you saw earlier. So younger people, lower income people, less educated people, renters, all of them, for a variety of reasons, are less likely to hold voter ID. And of course, what we know about the voter IDs that are allowed is student IDs aren't allowed on the one hand, but a variety of sort of age related over 65 IDs are, which gives a sense that not only is voter ID, even if it were neutral, probably something that those who don't turn out would be less likely to have, but the voter ID that we're getting doesn't appear to be completely neutral. The other thing I just wanted to note very quickly is who isn't turning out might change from election to election, depending on how discontented people are. So I ran a a survey with YouGov 3 weeks ago, or I guess a month ago, actually. It was right at the end of October. And in it, I can look at the group of people who didn't vote in 2019 and whether they say they'll vote now. So half of them still say they aren't going to vote, but a large majority of the rest of them, so 30% of all of them, 60% of the rest of them, are saying they'll vote for Labour now. And of the people who voted Conservative in the last election, 30% of them say they aren't going to vote for anyone, whereas of the people who voted Labour last time, fewer than 10%, right? So people are adjusting whether they want to come out and vote in terms of how angry they feel about the situation and how represented they feel. So it is a bit of a moving target, and we want to be a bit careful in thinking that those people who don't turn out are always going to be the same. There's probably a political dimension to it as well.
And while I have you, I come to Julia in a minute. It's often said, and I think there is some evidence for this in the data, that if you look at the rise of radical right parties, they are actually often pulling in people who traditionally don't vote. They're not switching away from other votes. So is that a tension between achieving political equality and the kind of things? I mean, I know it's, one has to take a view on the positions taken by such parties, and there will be different views about that. But how do we think about that? Because increases in political participation may well be a form of non-mainstream politics, not mainstream politics.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, I don't think that UKIP or Reform could really be called anti-system parties in the way that some radical right parties are anti-system. I mean, they definitely are skeptical of the system, but I suppose, does their existence lower political equality? I think that would be a strong thing to say. And Brexit did lead to very high turnout among people who hadn't felt represented beforehand. And I think we can view that as a democratic success, regardless of our views about the merits of leaving the European Union. What I will say, though, is at least looking at the data that I have right now in front of me, the people who didn't vote in the last election are not currently being attracted to those parties. So they're not saying, oh, I'll go and vote for Reform. In fact, looking at this, only 2% of those people who didn't vote last time are saying they'll vote for the Reform Party. So I'm not sure there is a great pool of those people right now. I think they all shifted to the Conservative Party after Brexit, and they were happy to some degree with Boris. Whether they're happy with Rishi Sunak is a different question.
Okay, thanks. So, Julia, would you like to come in?
I think perhaps Tim, you were thinking about the study on the Sweden Democrats, and we'll have evidence that is also similar in the French context. And I think it depends a little bit. Like, if you look at the way election works, I know that there are more than two parties in the UK, but at the end of the day, you still have like two very strong parties, while in like places like Sweden or France, we can have like much more parties because we have like these two-round elections. And in these countries, one of the things that we observe is that if you look at the characteristics of those people who abstain or those people who vote for the far right, at the end of the day, it tends to be similar from a number of point of view, in particular low education, low income. Now, like, to try to tackle like seriously your question, Tim, because I think it's a very important one. If we were to put in place some like policies that will increase turnout among those people, and so we know that the short term political consequences will be a rise in the let's say far right parties. I won't say that this would be good news, but I would say that this would be the cost to pay, because I think that part of the long-term increase in the vote shares obtained by these parties is really the rise in the representation gap. The fact that people are unhappy, in particular, not so much, I guess, with lack of gender representation, and age is another issue, but really with the fact that you do not have a good representation of the blue collar workers. That then you might ask me, why is it the case today and it was not the case 50 years ago? And I think from this point of view, this is linked to the fact that so I'm going to say a lot of things in like 2 minutes, and I think I would have to like argue for each point, but there is a huge literature. I'm not the first one thinking about that. But if you look at the kind of like policies that were implemented by the Labour Party in the UK in the 60s, 70s, or by the Democrats in the US or the Socialist Party until the end of the 1990s, like their economic policy was much more turned towards like the reduction of economic inequality and blue collar workers. So even basically to say it in a nutshell, if people were electing like white collars, like MPs, these white collars MPs were implementing policies that were turned toward like blue collars. And now, you know, you have all this debate about whether or not like the Democrats in the US, the Socialists in France, the Social Democrats in like Germany or the Labour Party in the UK basically are no longer fighting on the economic dimension, but are much more fighting on like cultural dimension. That also explain part of the results you presented on, like, you know, the new role played by education, income in the voting choice. And that explain, I guess, why the representation gap is taking more importance, because people are like looking at the MPs and like basically concluding that they are not like putting in place policies that are to their advantage. So they think that if the MPs were like them, descriptively, perhaps it would be different.
Great. So I'm going to go to the question of Paul Lee on the on Slido. He says as follows: there's one form of political inequality, a failure by politics to address it. Ashcroft's latest poll asked if parties, quote, stand for fairness. Only 4% think Tories do, and only 29% Labour. And then he says both results are terrible and describes this as a political failure. Do you have any thoughts? I think it links actually to Julia's last point in some ways. So I don't know whether Ben or Jane want to reflect on it. Should we be dismayed that so few voters think that parties stand for fairness? And what does that tell us, I mean, in terms of this debate that we're having today? Jane.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I think that, so one of the things that's kind of come up throughout this discussion, from your introduction, through Ben's presentation, through Julia's responses, is that there's this complicated kind of reciprocal relationship between economic and political inequality, in which one isn't entirely derivative of the other, but they're clearly sort of feeding off of each other. And I think one of the kind of side effects of both rising economic inequality and the sort of the way in which the political system has maybe failed to represent that is a decline of sort of trust and the belief in the efficacy of the state. And that then turns into, I think it's a vicious circle in terms of sort of voters' willingness to support policies, or potentially to sort of just act on electorally on policies that would hold politicians to account for particular forms of economic inequality. And so the question then is sort of like, what is in the driving these particular sets of perceptions? And so it may come in part from descriptive representation. There's also work that the way politicians themselves talk about fairness really matters. And so Tom O'Grady from UCL has a really nice new book out that sort of does a content analysis on political speech through the 90s and 2000s. And he finds that, you know, one of the things that happens is this, the way in which politicians, both on the left and on the right, begin to talk about questions of poverty and inequality takes a particular turn in which then I think feeds into this question about representation and the way that people feel about it. Now, these are not, I think, directly related to the concept of fairness as the questioner asked it, which I think have to do in part with beliefs about the procedures and the sort of quality of politicians and the way that they behave. But if we sort of put these things in a context in which one of the responses to rising income inequality is to change political parties, to sort of change their rhetoric about the population, in turn, potentially representing people less descriptively, and then this growing sense that there's a gap between what the policymakers are offering and how many people in the public are feeling, which in turn, I think, leads many people to turn off from politics. And it sort of takes away parts of that self-correction within the democratic process as it relates to the economy as a whole. And that this can be very damaging. I would also say a second thing. Actually, I'll hold on that. I'll let the others come in.
Well, let me build on this a little bit, because there's also a question in the chat, and it's something I wanted to come to because it relates to everything we're talking about on sort of the stronger forms of political engagement than just voting. So, you know, the ultimate one being, I suppose, to become a candidate for office. So, you know, we talked about voting already and the things that might disaffect people, but the whole issue of wider political engagement. I recently become an advisor to this project called Civic Future, which some of you may know about, that was set up by Munira Mirza to try and get more people to enter public life in the UK, to provide better training for potential candidates and just generally engage people. I mean, there's generally a sense, and at least, of course, we all speak to different people, but there's generally a sense of a kind of crisis in the sense in who's willing to put themselves forward for political office or to get engaged, you know, even putting leaflets through people's doors. I mean, one thing you find in an era of social media is that people get abused in what to me seem unspeakably unpleasant ways for putting their head above the parapet and engaging. How can we possibly improve the quality of civic engagement in its broadest sense, and not just voting, but actually putting yourself out there in a world where it seems that things are heading in exactly the opposite direction in terms of what we would need? And of course, some people say, oh, we just need to pay people more. I don't buy that personally. I think that's too narrow a take on this. It's really about how do we create a public sphere that is not toxic in the way our public sphere, I think, is heading. I don't know whether I'll invite Ben or Julia, but it could also be Jane, to give their take on how do we get people more engaged? Because I think it's a real challenge.
So I think Julia and Jane will have much more interesting things to say than me on this. But I do have one database bit of information that I think speaks to the fairness question, if not to your question there, Tim, which I think is a very challenging one that I'm just going to punt to others. I ran earlier this summer a survey about social mobility, and in it we asked people, do you think that you get your fair share? So a very, very general question like that, and 50% of people said yeah, more or less right in the middle, like neither too much neither too little. So it's funny, we thought oh, everybody will feel screwed over, and the average is, you know, that people feel they don't quite get their fair share. But I was quite surprised at how sort of broadly satisfied or the British public were with how they felt they were dealt with. And a lot of them also felt they got a fair chance to get ahead in life, a fair chance to get an education. The one place where there was a big difference is fair chance to get a house. But other than that, fairness in substantive terms, I was surprised at how little discontent there was about it. And of course, it may just be how we asked the question.
I don't know whether Julia or Jane want to reflect. I mean, not, as far as I know, neither of you are running for public office. Would you ever be tempted to?
No.
I think the data actually show that when the people like Nick Carnes and others that have gone out and surveyed people, that the ambition gaps, the place you can't kill them, is on gender. So like these are really, that you get these really big differences on gender, on the degree to which like even young girls think about running for office and women think about it. Whereas actually with men of different income groups, you get less is actually happening on the ambition side. It seems like where the action is on the mobilization or recruitment into politics. And I think Julie is absolutely right that the decline of unions in particular, and also the failure of unions to sort of update. So unions have become kind of more pink collar. They represent more women, but you still have huge parts of the sort of new working class, like women in the care sector. Well, you have some politicians like Angela Rayner that come from that background, but many fewer than there are actual workers in that are being mobilized into politics. And so the ambitions are sort of part of it, particularly on the gender side, where I think there's bigger socialization that's happening. But there's a lot is just about the recruitment and facilitation of people into politics. The good news about that is that actually can be changed relatively quickly. So quotas are one of the things that can matter, but there's all sorts of things that parties can do in the short run. And we've seen this. I mean, the conservative front bench has become much more sort of radically diversified in the last decade. And that's that you have organizations out there like Operation Black Vote, who are doing a lot of work on sort of training young candidates and getting them into the political scene. And this can change within the space of a decade. And so there are things in some sense that are deep-seated, but there's also things that are actually really about sort of the mechanics of party organization, recruitment, and mobilization that I think can change in a much shorter amount of time and that really need more attention, but also political willingness from elites in terms of like sort of where, because when they do it, they, it can happen pretty quickly.
Thanks. Julia, do you have a reflection on that?
No, I was just going to say that we don't have to wait parties to do it by themselves. This is something that we really learned with gender quotas, that I guess when the law changed, they have no other choice and there is like no cost for them. Like people are very happy with like voting for women. Nick Carnes, at some point, he also did like some like survey data with co-authors when he asked people, do you have a preference to vote like for blue collar or white collar? And people are perfectly happy to vote for like blue collar workers. So the issue is that you need to change the rules of the game. Very often when we talk about gender, people agree. When we talk about minorities, it becomes a little bit more complicated because then people say, ah, should we think about like nationality? Should we think about religion? How should we measure that? And then people can. And then like the argument that is very often used is kind of saying that it's too complicated. So for example, if you want to have like a fair share of like blue collar workers, but you know, some blue collar workers are poor and others are rich. How are you going to take that into account? So then you can say, okay, it's going to be about income. But very often, you know, the argument that is pushed is to say, ah, it's too complicated. We don't want to put the fingers in the door. And I think we should argue and use historical examples to show that this is not so complicated. In a country like India, so it's a different context, huh? But in a country like India, in a sense, they have had a reservation both for like gender and people from like poor economic backgrounds, like since the 1950s, and it worked pretty well. But we have to be careful in the way all these different things are implemented, obviously. Just going to give you an example, and this is why you will realize that if you do not force party, it's not going to work. So if you take, before I was mentioning Brazil, so Brazil they first introduced gender quotas in 1995. It applied in 1998. And then more recently, they have introduced minorities quota. So quotas for Black and what they call the mixed race people. And what happened is that like between like two elections, you had more than half of the white candidates that became Black, self-declared, because you self-declared your race. And the other thing that they did is that they implement some rulings on how much of your like public funding for campaigns you need to give for women. And then you see, so there is a rise because they had no choice on how much money they were giving to women. But then you see much less expenditures by women than by male candidates. And when you look at the data, just realize that parties where they were giving the money to female candidates just 1 week before the deadline, so that they did not have enough time to spend it. There is a lot of resistance. So you say you gave us example like showing that de facto you can have some initiatives at work and you can change things quickly, but there is still a lot of resistance against equal political representation from a descriptive point of view. So I think this is really where we need to have like some strong change in the law, with some also financial sanctions to parties that won't obey these rules.
Okay, thank you. So there's a question in about the role of the first past the post system in all of this, and I'm not 100% sure what the questioner has in mind. But one interpretation of this is if you live in a safe constituency, then pretty much your vote is irrelevant because you know that somebody's who's going to win that. That's an obvious form of political inequality. But more generally, the sense of efficacy within the political system when in the first past the post system, given what you have to do to win elections in that system, may have implications that just push against that. So I don't know whether who would like to come in on the question of how far the first past the post system is a culprit here, and if we moved to a more proportional system or whatever version you would like, we might change things.
So I'm broadly convinced that proportional systems are more representative because they sort of technologically are more representative. The only way that can screw up is if you have parties that just come into office and fail to do everything they said. Now, of course, there are challenges in the way that coalitions form and the policies are produced at the end. And we might worry about gridlock, or we might just worry about horse trading in those coalitions and say that's a problem. But it seems hard for me to make a case that proportional representation parliaments are somehow less representative. They almost necessarily have to be. I do think the challenge in the UK is where are marginal seats and whose votes matter in marginal seats. The findings that we have is, in terms of the demographics that matter most in marginal seats over the last three elections, age actually is the thing that mattered most. And so that might explain why both British political parties do seem to cater in their policies to pensioners. I mean, one could argue, of course, that things like the triple lock, the real beneficiaries of it are people who are younger than pensioners, provided that they get a pension in the future, because they're going to get more years of higher pensions. But I don't think, in fact, that's the political logic of it. The political logic of it is this is a good way to keep those marginal voters on side. The other thing, I think somebody in Slido mentioned, you know, talking about the regions of the United Kingdom, and it's blindingly obvious that Scotland has been entirely unrepresented in British politics for the last 15 years. The Conservative Party have displayed very little interest in making policies that's supported by Scots, at least after this sort of brief Ruth Davison moment. So I think those geographical inequalities of representation are really, really important, and they are fundamental to the survival or lack thereof of the union. And so they may not necessarily be about economic issues to the degree that Scotland has the same GDP per capita as the rest of the country, but they are important forms of political inequality.
Yeah, just adding to that, I'm sitting in London. London has voted overwhelmingly for non-conservative MPs for quite a while now, and yet that's not been there. So, you know, the Scotland case, I agree, is a very glaring case, but, you know, you could take on other significant areas of the country and make the same kind of argument. So I don't know whether Julia or Jane, you want to come in on the first past the post electoral system. No. So we can turn to an intriguing question. I'm going to put it in a stark way. Is class dead as a way of looking at elections? I mean, at one point, you know, a kind of classic Marxist analysis would see everything in terms of some kind of socioeconomic class. But, you know, you didn't use that category in your paper, as far as I remember. Ben and Jane, you used more standardly measured things. I don't even remember, Julia, you may have used the term class, but I don't even recall that. Is this just a passé way of thinking about politics? And does that have implications once we stop thinking in terms of categories like class? I mean, is that a better way of thinking about political equality, washing that out? Or is that actually debates about political inequality are sort of impoverished by ignoring class?
Jane,
you're on mute. Yeah, come in.
Sorry. Okay, I'll start with that. No, I mean, I think you're right. Like, so class, I think there's no way you can talk about contemporary politics without talking about class. But I think that there's sort of two things that change over time. So the first is that the nature of class structures has fairly substantially changed. And so the kind of old class schemas, the way we think about class as sort of workers and owners in a sense where people are defined with respect to the sort of relationship they have to the means of production, that clearly as a simplifying technique becomes much, much more complicated. And it's already even more complicated by the 1960s, but it just grows in its complexity over time. And so, you know, there's a proliferation of typologies of class that begins in the 70s, 80s, 90s, in terms of rethinking about how do we think about class and in the current moment. And when we sort of measure class in the old way, the sort of structuring power of class over the vote falls. But when we think about class in a new way that sort of takes apart a number of sort of occupational and educational constellations, there's still a strong social structure that affects how people behave politically. And so in what we're capturing with education in some regards, it's just a very simplified measure of different, a new sort of diversified form of class. And we certainly see that in terms of thinking about the working class as well, that the sort of manual working class has shrunk fairly dramatically over time. But there's all sorts of new workers in the service sector, much more sort of women workers in the care sector and other sectors who are parts of the kind of new working class. And these economic realities for them matter substantially, and the way that they emerge into politics structures it in really substantial ways. So that big educational shift we see in voting is partly really a class shift at the rise of these kind of more sociocultural, what we call kind of more sociocultural professionals, people who work with people with high levels of education. They're sort of a distinct class group, and they're driving a lot of that shift on the left, the educated left. And then within the working class, we see different trends across sort of manual and non-manual workers. And so I think as an economic reality, class absolutely still exists. As a structuring reality in voting, it still exists. But what's interesting is that the connection between those two has become more complicated in terms of the way the sort of political manifestation of class actually appears. I think, though, the bigger thing in terms of the response to the question is, yeah, I think we are really impoverished if we stop talking about that, because the advantage that class has as an analysis is not just sort of workers' relationship to the means of production, but it's like thinking about disadvantage and advantages over a life cycle in a much more holistic way. And I think when we're thinking about economic inequality and how it translates into political inequality and the sort of reciprocal relationship there, the way in which people's reality is structured, not just by their job, but by the sort of broader life chances that they have, the opportunities they have, the schools that they have access to, the resources over the life cycle, class is a much more encompassing concept than something like an educational category or an experience that's associated with just your work right now. And so I think bringing that back, I think your questioner is right to kind of push on that and to bring that really back in a sense of saying, like, you know, we need to talk about class and to think about the way that that intersects with politics, and not to pretend that the trends that we're seeing that relate to educational realignment are sort of a classless trend, because those really build on new class dynamics.
Thank you. Julia, do you have a reflection from across the channel? Do you still talk in terms of class politics in France?
Huh. Social scientists will. The main issue is about political parties. The political parties are not talking enough about class politics, but when as an economist, like looking at the data, I work at the on the long-term evolution of turnout in France, what I see as one of the main drivers of the difference in turnout still today, and in fact, more today than 15 years ago, it's just income. You want to explain turnout, you rank, you know, all your explanatory variables, you look over the long run, and like income is playing a much higher role today explaining the drop in turnout than any other factors. So class still play a huge role. And I think one of the issues that we face, and the reason why we have this like increasing like a representation gap, is that political parties do no longer take class into account. The other thing that I want to highlight, and this is based a little bit, you know, all the work that has been done by Amaury Guettin, Thomas Piketty, Clara Tolenado in their book on like political cleavage, you see that it's like the fact that you have like new dimensions such as education, it does not mean that income no longer plays a role. It just means that you have different kind of elite, and that before it was like low income, high income, and now it's like much more complicated because you have low income, high income, low education, high education. But it also means that some people who are like low income, low education, they really don't face as of today any like political party platforms. So in a sense, I think that class is perhaps even more important than in the past, that you see that in the data when you look at political participation. But it has also become like more complex, because before perhaps they were like just like one dimension, and now you have like many other dimensions to take into account.
Thanks. And Ben, 1 minute on class, or do you want to pass?
I'm happy to pass to get another question in if we have time.
Yeah, so there's a question that responds to something that Julia said, that David Vincent, that Labour is looking more like the Conservatives. And of course, it's a classic proposition in political economy that elections are all about the centre ground. And the question is, then who loses if it's the centre ground that's getting most of the political attention? Maybe that means in particular people of lower socioeconomic status are actually almost by that force, their interests are relatively less adhered to. So A, is that correct? That, you know, we are really in an era where Keir Starmer's platform is going to look really no different from the government that he replaces if he wins the next election. And, you know, did Cameron's look very different from Brown and Blair's? Probably not. So we're just sort of in a world where politics doesn't matter because it's always the same. Is that right or wrong? 30 seconds from each of you on that.
Well, I have a very quick answer to that, which is that David Soskus was right about this a few years ago when he argued that first past the post systems tend to push to the center right as middle income swing voters worry that they'll be a kind of minority if Labour get elected and get taxed to the max, whereas if the Conservatives get elected, the worst that happens is that there aren't any taxes. I do think our electoral system disfavors the left and drives the Labour Party to adopt centre-right mantra about economics more than it drives the Conservative Party to adopt the left. Now, I acknowledge that there are people on the Conservative Party who, you know, think Rishi Sunak is a socialist. So a lot of this is, it depends on one's starting position, but I'm with Soskus on that.
Okay, very good. We're almost out of time. Did Jane or Julia want to have a word on this? If not, we'll
I'll say one quick thing, which is that, you know, British politics has always been described as a sort of convergence. So you said in the past, we describe it as butskalism in the 50s and 60s, the idea that sort of there was this, the left and the right sort of shared a lot. But I think what Julia has really been pushing on this discussion is we have to think about parties as actors that are sort of broader than just like a single election manifesto. And I think what probably changed was the way that parties more systematically related to voters, even sort of in between elections, not just what they did in sort of a sense in office, that we do see this decline over time in the sense that workers or people that define themselves as working class have, that the Labour Party stands for them. And I think also the symmetrically, the same would be true of upper income people in the Conservative Party. And so that there's a less of a sense that, well, even if they're sort of saying the same thing, they've kind of got my back. And maybe this goes back to some of the questions about trust that we had before. And so when we think about political parties in the longer, as not just actors that are sort of presenting an election to election manifesto, but that are sort of mobilizing people more systematically into politics over the long run, there does appear to be a real shift there in the way in which voters conceive of parties as representing them. And then that makes this kind of what they see as sort of a lack of difference as potentially demobilizing.
Well, thank you. And I'm afraid I have to draw this to a close. It's been a great discussion, fantastic presentations. And I hope for those of you who joined us, it's given you an opportunity to reflect on which are really important issues and will be quite central to some of what the review does in its synthesis volume, which is very much underway at this point. I thank those of you who joined us online and particularly those who gave us some questions to chew over. And I wish you a very good afternoon and weekend. Bye-bye.